Hi, and welcome to the 2021 Summer Book Buzz at the Allen Public Library. I'm Abby.
And I'm Kristen, and we'd like to share with you some of the most anticipated new books available to you this summer at the library. All books mentioned today are available in both print and ebook formats.
All of our book summaries today were provided by the publishers. So my first book I'm going to mention today is The Maidens by Alex Michaelides. This is the author of The Silent Patient, so his new book, The Maidens. Edward Fosca is a murderer. Of this, Mariana is certain. But Fosca is untouchable. A handsome and charismatic Greek tragedy professor at Cambridge University, Fosca is adored by staff and students alike, particularly by the members of a secret society of female students known as The Maidens. But Mariana Andros is a brilliant but troubled group therapist who becomes fixated on the maidens when one member, a friend of her niece, is found murdered in Cambridge. Mariana, who herself a past student of the university, quickly suspects that behind the idyllic beauty of the spires and turrets and beneath the ancient traditions lies something sinister. She becomes convinced that, despite his alibi, Edward Fosca is guilty of the murder. But why would the professor target one of his students? And why does he keep returning to the rites of Persephone, the maiden, and her journey to the underworld? When another body is found, Mariana's obsession with proving Fosca's guilt spirals out of control, threatening to destroy her credibility as well as her closest relationships. But Mariana is determined to stop this killer, even if it costs her everything. I was able to receive an advance copy of this book, and I absolutely loved it. It's a very well-paced mystery thriller with some Greek mythology and tragedy thrown in. And also, was something else I really enjoyed about this book is that every once in a while, a chapter from the villain's point of view is read, and that just kind of makes the book even more suspenseful and really makes you eager to finish it. I also listened to the audiobook, and I feel like that made this book even much better experience because it's narrated by Louise Brealey, who is a British actress, and also what I thought was fun was that she played the character Molly Hooper in Sherlock, the one with Benedict Cumberbatch. Cool. I thought that was fun. She also does a lot of different voices for all the characters. So her narration makes it a really lovely, lovely book. And it's also narrated by another British Ghanaian actor, Kopna Holbrook-Smith. He narrates the chapters from the villain's point of view, and he has this really dark and mysterious voice that really brings you into the story. So I really enjoyed. So I highly recommend The Maidens. My next book is The Secret Keeper of Jampur by Alika Joshi. This is the sequel to the author's first book, The Henna Artist. So the year is 1969, and Malik, Lashami's younger helper from the first novel, is now an educated young man apprenticed at the Jaunpur Palace and working on building the state-of-the-art public movie house when he becomes ensnared in a smuggling scheme that threatens all he aspires to, including the woman he loves. 12 years after Lashami leaves Jaunpur to work at Dr. Kumar's clinic, she is now happily married and has taken under her wing a young tribal widow, Nimi, who is raising her two young children on her own. Gold smuggling is rampant in the nearby mountains, and Nimi's brother has fallen to temptations. Afraid that her enterprising helper, Malik, now a young man who has recently finished his education, will also be lured into the treacherous business, Lashami arranges for him to apprentice in Jaunpur at the palace. So back in the Pink City, where he was once a wily street urchin, Malik again encounters the wealthy Singhs, including Samir Singh, fleckless son Ravi, who caused Lakshmi's younger sister so much heartache. Malik is assigned to help Ravi Singh build the new public cinema. And when the cinema balcony collapses on opening night, it signals trouble for Malik and for Lakshmi too. Malik is implicated in a ruthless scandal of Ravi's making that will ultimately threaten his livelihood, his reputation, and the people he loves most. My next book is The Chosen and the Beautiful by Naji Vo. Immigrant, socialite, magician. Jordan Baker grows up in the most rarefied circles of 1920s American society. She has money, education, a killer golf handicap, and invitations to some of the most exclusive parties of the jazz age. She's also queer, Asian, adopted, and treated as an exotic attraction by her peers, while the most important doors remain closed to her. But the world is full of wonders, infernal pacts and dazzling illusions, lost ghosts, and elemental mysteries. In all paper is fire, and Jordan can burn the cut paper heart out of a man. She just has to learn how. Vo's debut novel, The Chosen and the Beautiful, reinvents this classic of the American canon as a coming-of-age story full of magic, mystery, and glittering excess, and introduces a major new voice, literary voice. This next one is It Happened One Summer by Tessa Bailey. Piper Bellinger is fashionable, influential, and her reputation as a wild child means the paparazzi are constantly on her heels. When way too much champagne and an out-of-control rooftop party lands her in the slammer, her stepfather decides enough is enough. He cuts her off and sends Piper and her sister to learn some responsibility by running their late father's dive bar in Washington. Piper hasn't been in Westport for 5 minutes when she meets big bearded sea captain Brandon, who thinks she won't last a week outside of Beverly Hills, but she is determined to show her father and now the hot grumpy local that she is more than just a pretty face. Except it is a small town, and everywhere she churns, she bumps into Brandon. The fun-loving socialite and the gruff fisherman are polar opposites, but there's an undeniable attraction simmering between them. Piper doesn't want any distractions, especially feelings for a man who sails off into the sunset for weeks at a time. Yet as she reconnects with her past and begins to feel at home in Westport, Piper starts to wonder if the cold, glamorous life she knew is what she truly wants. LA is calling, but Brandon and this town full of memories may have already caught her heart. This is another one I read. I got an advanced reader copy of this one as well, and I really enjoyed it. It's a really sweet little rom-com of a book, and it's a perfect summer read because it's fast-paced and does have a decent love story between the polar opposites trope. If you can kind of push through and get through to the good parts, the main character, Piper, is pretty annoying at times because she is like a 29-year-old acting like a 16-year-old, but she does means well. The good side of the story is that Piper actually getting to know the town where her birth father came from and actually growing as a person. So that was, you know, that was a really good point. That really made up for most parts in the middle where she's kind of acts like a spoiled brat. But this is, I do, again, highly recommend this book if you're looking for a nice quick summer read. And my next book is The Women's March by Jennifer Shiverini. 25-year-old Alice Paul returns to her native New Jersey after several years on the front lines of the suffrage movement in Great Britain. Weakened from imprisonment and hunger strikes, she is nevertheless determined to invigorate the stagnant suffrage movement in her homeland. So to inspire support for the campaign, Alice organizes a magnificent procession down Pennsylvania Avenue in Washington, D.C., the day before the inauguration of President-elect Woodrow Wilson, a firm anti-suffragist. Joining the march is 39-year-old New Yorker Maud Malone, librarian and advocate for women's and workers' rights. The daughter of Irish immigrants, Maud has acquired a reputation and a criminal record for interrupting politicians' speeches with pointed questions they'd rather ignore. Civil rights activist and journalist Ida B. Wells Barnett resolves that women of color must also be included in the march and the proposed amendment. Born into slavery in Mississippi, Ida worries that white suffragettes may exclude black women if it serves their own interests. So on March 3, 1913, the Glorious March commences, and negligent police allow vast crowds of belligerent men to block the parade route, jeering, shouting threats, and assaulting the marchers, endangering not only the success of the demonstration, but the women's very lives. Inspired by actual events, the Women's March offers a fascinating account of a crucial but little-remembered moment in American history, a turning point in the struggle for women's rights. And my last book to discuss is titled She Who Became the Sun by Shelley Parker Chan. Mulan meets the Song of Achilles in Shelley Parker Chan's She Who Became the Sun, a bold, queer, and lyrical reimagining of the rise of the founding empire of the Ming Dynasty from an amazing new voice in literary fantasy. It's 1345, China lies under harsh Mongol rule. For the starving peasants of the Central Plains, greatness is something found only in stories. When the Zhu family's eighth-born son, Zhu Changba, is given a fate of greatness, everyone is mystified as to how it will come to pass. The fate of nothingness received by the family's clever and capable second daughter, on the other hand, is only as expected. When a bandit attack orphans the two children, though, it is Zhu Changba who succumbs to despair and dies. Desperate to escape her own fated death, the girl uses her brother's identity to enter a monastery as a young male novice. There, propelled by her burning desire to survive, Zhu learns she is capable of doing whatever it takes, no matter how callous, to stay hidden from her fate. And after her sanctuary is destroyed for supporting the rebellion against Mongol rule, Zhu takes the chance to claim another future altogether, her brother's abandoned greatness.
Okay. My first title is Malibu Rising by Taylor Jenkins Reid, the popular author of Seven Husbands of Evelyn Hugo. Malibu, August 1983. It's the day of Nina Riva's annual end-of-summer party, and anticipation is at a fever pitch. Everyone wants to be around the famous Rivas. Nina, the talented surfer and supermodel, brothers Jay and Hud, one a championship surfer, the other a renowned photographer, and their adored baby sister Kit. Together, the siblings are a source of fascination in Malibu and the world over, especially as the offspring of the legendary singer Mick Riva. The only person not looking forward to the party of the year is Nina herself, who never wanted to be the center of attention and who has also just been very publicly abandoned by her pro tennis player husband. Oh, and maybe Hud, because it is long past time for him to confess something to the brother from whom he's been inseparable since birth. Jay, on the other hand, is counting the minutes until nightfall, when the girl he can't stop thinking about promised she'll be there. And Kit has a couple secrets of her own, including a guest she invited without consulting anyone. By midnight, the party will be completely out of control. By morning, the Riva mansion will have gone up in flames. But before that first spark in the early hours before dawn, the alcohol will flow, the music will play, and the loves and secrets that shaped the family's generations will all come bubbling to the surface. My review. I loved The Seven Husbands of Evelyn Hugo, and this is a follow-up and is about one of her seven husbands, the nightclub singer Mick Riva, and his family, namely his children. I enjoyed this very much, and the story is exciting, yet it did lack some of the magic of Evelyn Hugo for me. However, I think fans of that book will find much to enjoy in this author's newest title. My second book is also by a popular author, Ellen Hildebrand, and it's her newest, called Golden Girl. In this satisfying page-turner from The Queen of Beach Reads, according to the New York Magazine, a Nantucket novelist has one final summer to protect her secrets while her loved ones on Earth learn to live without their golden girl. On a perfect June day, Vivian Howe, author of 13 beach novels and mother of three nearly grown children, is killed in a hit-and-run accident while jogging near her home on Nantucket. She ascends to the beyond, where she's assigned to a person named Martha, who allows her to watch what happens below for one last summer. Vivi is also granted three nudges to change the outcome of events on Earth, and with her daughter Willa on her third miscarriage, Carson partying until all hours, and Leo currently off again with his high-maintenance girlfriend, she'll have to think carefully where to use them. From the beyond, Vivian watches the chief, Ed Kapanash, investigate her death, but her greatest worry is her final book, which contains a secret from her own youth that could be disastrous for her reputation. But when hidden truths come to light, Vivi's family will have to sort out their past and present mistakes, with or without a nudge of help from above, while Vivian finally lets them grow without her. My review. This was just an okay read for me. It started out really promising, but took a sharp turn in order to solve the mystery surrounding her death, which seemed quite obvious to me the whole time. I much preferred her other recent books, The Summer of 69 and 28 Summers. However, I think fans of her books, as well as others looking for a more intriguing and mysterious speech read, will enjoy this very much. My next book is The Personal Librarian by the well-known historical fiction author Marie Benedict, along with Victoria Christopher Murray. The remarkable little-known story of Belle DaCosta Green, J.P. Morgan's personal librarian, who became one of the most powerful women in New York, despite the dangerous secret she kept in order to make her dreams come true, from New York Times bestselling author Marie Benedict and acclaimed author Victoria Christopher Murray. In her 20s, Belle DaCosta Green is hired by J.P. Morgan to curate a collection of rare manuscripts, books, and artwork for his newly built Pierpont Morgan Library. Belle becomes a fixture on the New York society scene and one of the most powerful people in the art and book world, known for her impeccable taste and shrewd negotiating for critical works as she helps build a world-class collection. But Belle has a secret, one she must protect at all costs. She was born not Belle DaCosta Green, but Belle Marion Greener. She is the daughter of Richard Greener, the first Black graduate of Harvard, and a well-known advocate for equality. Belle's complexion isn't dark because of her alleged Portuguese heritage that lets her pass as white. Her complexion is dark because she is African-American. The personal librarian tells the story of an extraordinary woman famous for her intellect, style, and wit, and shares the lengths to which she must go for the protection of her family and her legacy to preserve her carefully crafted white identity in the racist world in which she lives. My review. This was a very interesting look at early libraries and highlighted how one strong and unforgettable librarian helped preserve history and in doing so made history herself. As a librarian, I liked this very much. I think anyone who loves libraries or books will enjoy her story. I also liked how it explored racism and prejudice in America. My next book is The Startup Wife by Tamina Anam. Newlyweds Asha and Cyrus build an app that replaces religious rituals and soon find themselves running one of the most popular social media platforms in the world. Meet Asha Ray. Brilliant coder and possessor of a pie tattoo, Asha is poised to revolutionize artificial intelligence when she is reunited with her high school crush, Cyrus Jones. Cyrus inspires Asha to write a new algorithm. Before she knows it, she's abandoned her PhD program, they've exchanged vows, and gone to work at an exclusive tech incubator called Utopia. The platform creates a sensation with millions of users seeking personalized rituals every day. Will Cyrus and Asha's marriage survive the pressures of sudden fame, or will she become overshadowed by the man everyone is calling the new Messiah? In this gripping, blistering novel, award-winning author Tamina Anam takes on faith in the future with a gimlet eye and a deft touch. Come for the radical vision of human connection, stay for the wickedly funny feminist look at startup culture and partnership. Can technology, with all its limits and possibilities, disrupt love? My review. I haven't read this yet, but from early reviews, it sounds like this will be one to keep its readers excited this summer. It has it all: love, social media, and technology. One reviewer from the Avonlaw Books blog calls it hip and even a little hipster, but it's also down to earth. Sounds like one we will all enjoy reading. And my next one is called If It Rains by Jennifer L. Wright, and it's inspirational fiction. It's 1935 in Oklahoma, and lives are determined by the dust. 14-year-old Catherine Bell, a Spitfire born with severe club foot, is coming of age in desperate times. Once her beloved sister marries, Catherine's only comfort comes in the well-worn pages of her favorite book, The Wonderful Wizard of Oz. Then Catherine's father decides to relocate to Indianapolis, and only the promise of a surgery to finally make her normal convinces Catherine to leave Oklahoma behind. But disaster strikes along the way, and Catherine must rely on her grit and the ragged companion she meets on the road if she is to complete her journey. Back in Boise City, her sister Melissa Mayfield is the newest member of the wealthiest family in all of Cimarron County. In spite of her poor rural upbringing, Melissa has just married the town's most eligible bachelor and is determined to be everything her husband and her new social class expects her to be. But as the drought tightens its grip, Henry's true colors are revealed. Melissa covers her bruises with expensive new makeup and struggles to reconcile her affluent life with that of her starving neighbors. Haunted by the injustice and broken by Henry's refusal to help, Melissa secretly defies her husband, risking her life to follow God's leading. Two sisters, struggling against unspeakable hardship, discover that even in their darkest times, they are still united in spirit, and God is still with them, drawing them home. My review. I haven't read this one, but it's bound to be a popular inspirational and historical fiction novel. Books on the Dust Bowl are currently very popular, as evidenced by Kristen Hannah's extremely popular The Four Winds, and this one sounds intriguing and harrowing. It's also set close to home in Oklahoma. And my last book was probably my favorite. This is The Other Passenger by Louise Candlish. You're feeling pretty smug about your commute to work by riverboat. No more traffic gridlock or getting stuck on the tube in tunnels, which is good because you're claustrophobic. Now you've got an iconic Thames River view, fresh air, a whole lifestyle upgrade. You've made new friends aboard, led by your hedonistic young neighbor, Kit, and just had your first Water Rats Christmas drinks. But the first day back after Christmas, Kit isn't on the morning boat. The river landmarks are all the same, but something's off. You disembark to find the police waiting. Kit's wife, Malia, has reported him missing, and another passenger witnessed the two of you arguing on the last boat home after your drinks. Police say you had a reason to lash out at him, to kill him. You protest. You and Kit are friends. Ask Malia. She'll vouch for you. And who exactly is this other passenger pointing the finger? What do they know about your private lives? No, whatever coincidences might have occurred that night, you are innocent, totally innocent. My review. I devoured this book in just a few days. It's the perfect summer read, intriguing, mysterious, and keeps you guessing until the very last second. This was the first book I've read by this author, but it won't be the last. It has romance and drama, yet also is very descriptive of the day-to-day lives of the characters. Highly recommended.
All right, so before we go, we'd also like to tell you about our book recommendation service, which is called Next Reads. To participate in this, you just have to fill out a short form and get 3 to 5 titles from our personalized suggestion service right into your inbox. There's also a new feature on our Next Reads service, which includes you can either choose a personalized recommendation list or a library bundle. A library bundle is actually a librarian will choose at least 5 items based on your recommendation and preferences that you listed in your form, and they will be placed on hold for you. So check out this our Next Read service today on our website.
Okay, the Shared Shelf Book Club will meet again in September to discuss our Alan Reed selection, The Bookwoman of Troublesome Creek by Kim Michelle Richardson.
And a handout of all of these titles that we mentioned today, plus a few more, will be available on our website as well. We'd like to leave you today with a question. What was your favorite summer read? So please leave your title or titles in the comments. Thank you for listening today.
Thank you.